Praise the Lord. Good morning. Welcome to Top Quality Faith Ministries. We are excited to lift up the name of the Lord. This is Takia. I'm Jamila, and we've got the worship team here with us praising in our Lord and our King. But we're going to pray before we get into our singing and playing, so join us. God, we thank you for your presence here today. We thank you that you desire for your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so, God, we align our hearts with you, our minds with you. We lay down and surrender everything that might stand in the way of us accepting and performing your will. So today, God, we ask that you just receive our worship, and we trust that you today will give us a new and fresh word and understanding that we might be transformed by the renewing of our minds to be and to do all that you have called forth. We thank you for these things. We thank you for all the ways you bless us every day, all day. Even in the ways we don't even know you're blessing us, God, you are preparing things for us. You are making our path straight, God, and we're grateful. So we give you our gratitude and express our thanksgiving today in worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
fails and never gives up and never runs out on me.
That is so constant for us. Your love overwhelms us, Lord. Your love loves us even when we don't love ourselves. Your love is constant, and we thank you for that, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
preach, it will be done, oh God, in every area of our lives, that your name might be glorified and all may come to know that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
God, you're so great. You're so great. The word of God says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Oh God, let our lives praise you. Let our worship truly praise you.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise.
You are so good. You're great, great, excellent, magnificent, glorious. Oh God, you are worthy to receive all honor, all glory, all of our praise. We exalt you today. And thank you for the gift of being able to worship you. Thank you for welcoming us as your beloved children, Abba. We have a home in you. We welcome you in our own hearts. And just thank you for being our God and King.
Yes, sir.
A true Father. A true Father.
Yes, Lord. You're so good.
God, today receive our worship.
Yes, Lord.
By your grace. We love worshiping you. We love worshiping you. And so, God, this time is all yours. Our lives are all yours. Whatever you desire to do, we will continue to surrender, God. You know what's best. You know what is best. We will trust you. And we will continue to give you the praise that's due unto you. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Praise God. God is so amazing. Lord, we love you so much. We don't stop worshiping. Praise God. We worship in our lifestyles and everything we do. We do as unto the Lord, as the word of God says. So even now, we welcome you to continue in worship with us and worship in our giving. You can see on your screen some different ways you can give unto the house of God, or you can give via Zelle or PayPal to finance@tqfm.org if you'd like to give an offering. You can also pray with us or have us pray for you by contacting us at prayer@tqfm.org. We will be sure to lift up your prayer requests if you email us there. And typically on Sundays, someone is here to pray with you if you want to pray live, and you can just dial into our Uber conference number. So we're going to take a short break, and then our messenger will be with us with the word of God. Praise God.
Welcome to Top Quality Faith Ministries. Wow, another day in the house just to praise and celebrate with our Lord. You know, the funny thing about today is I had an opportunity to sit before God. And as I was sitting before God, you know, I was asking, you know, what is the message for today? What is it that Top Quality Faith can benefit from today's message? And, you know, I was looking at a host of things, and as I began to look at the things that was going on around, you know, for some reason or another, I found myself focused on, you know, little things. And as I began to focus on these little things, and none of the things that I was focused on, I'm going to truly say, give honor or praise unto God, okay? I'll give you a perfect example. I was trying to get into the message, and my whole idea was always on my backyard. And I was just trying my best to get back center focus. And I began to do a constant walkthrough through my backyard. And as I was walking through, I then had to stop, and I had to get myself into focus. And I had to literally say, okay, Lord, outside is not important right now. What's on the inside is of me to deliver the message is way more important than outside. But the funny part about it is he kept shifting me back to outside too. And as he began to shift me back to the outside, he was giving me ideas and he was putting something in me. So what I thought was important wasn't important. Hopefully you guys get what I'm saying. I thought was important to me wasn't important, but he made it important to me because I walked through, and as I was walking through the backyard, I was like, Lord, you're this, you're that. And I began to call out some great things about my Lord. And I'm like, you're a God of restoration. You're a God of love. You're a God that provides direction, hope, peace, love. And then I kind of figured as I was praising him and literally focusing on these things about him, that I would put myself into the place that I could hear the message. But he took me back outside, and he literally began to deal with the things that I thought was important. And so it allowed me to see that God is always in the center of conversations if you will allow him. And what he deems to be of importance, he will bring it to pass, but he will cause you to understand what's important to you matters as well. And so how do I get you guys into today's message? Well, I have this crazy plant that I bought from downtown, and I don't know what the plant is. Saya told me it's some kind of plant that's supposed to represent money or whatever. I just think it's cute. I have no, you know, idea what it is. Don't care what it is, but it's just beautifully arranged to me, and that's what caught my eye, and that's why I bought it, because it was something uniquely different. But God has a purpose and a plan for all things, and so I'm going to talk about this plant because it makes sense to me to dial this into my message in order to get you guys to understand what God is basically saying to us at this particular time and hour. I'm going to go into the scripture in just a moment, but I want to start off in the simple place of trusting the Holy Spirit in introducing this to you guys. You know, I started off with basically saying what we present to him matters to him. Even the things that we think that doesn't matter to God does matter to God. And so how do I start this topic off, Lord? He said you must talk about how one sees one another. Funny. You know, I'm a person that's always looking and always inspecting fruit. And as I'm looking and I'm expecting fruit, you know, I can see opportunities within individuals and the need for, how would I say, elevation. But I can also see in myself opportunities in the need for elevation. At one point or time in my life, I would always try to be the fixer of not only myself, but of man. But now I'm smart enough to know that if the Holy Spirit doesn't say something about it, don't touch it. But I'm also smart enough to basically understand that if I'm going through something, it is not my responsibility to push it off on others, because it's my own inability to trust God, or it's something that God is allowing me to see to walk me through. Sometimes it's my own inability to trust God, but God is also providing me insight in many areas to help me to really understand what it means to love his body, what it means to love the way he has given us the example of how we should love one another. And so as I began to look at this plant, what really stood out to me was, you know, number one, in the vases supported that I got three in one. I got three in one, okay? I got four different types of plants in one. And it's easy to take care of, okay? All I gotta do is pour a little bit of water in it and it does its own work. I don't have to nurse it. I don't have to do anything. I'm not good with living plants, okay? I love roses because they take care of themselves. I really believe that, you know, if it's a plant, it's supposed to take care of itself. Okay, throw a little water at it, and even if I don't give it the right type of water, take care of yourself. You know, every once in a while I may turn around and talk to it, you know, if I see it's taking care of itself, like, oh my God, you're doing a good job. But I was told that you're supposed to talk to your plants, do all of this stuff. I don't have time for that. You know, the only time I'm going to talk to you when I see you dying, okay? And I'm just going to be real. The only time I see you dying, I'm going to have a conversation. Other than that, there will be no conversation. You are beautiful. I bought you a beautiful. You stay beautiful.
Yes.
But that's the way we look at people. We expect people when we meet them, and whatever really attracted us to that individual, we want it to be there forever, okay? Girl, you know why I picked you as my friend, right? You know why we together, right? Because you do this and you do that, and you're supposed to stay that way. And so when he or she begins to change in some setting, you're like, wait a minute, we friends because you were this way, okay? We are not friends when you start acting like this, so no, you stay like this. doing something else. You're like, we got, everybody got one of them in their family. Don't we say that? Ooh, everybody got one of them. But then you say, ooh, I got two. Oh my God, got three. And we begin to put them in a different box, and we tend to separate them and cause them to stand alone. Wow. I'm gonna ask Anita, can you do me a favor? Or can you do me a favor? Can you go into my bathroom? I got another one of them in that bathroom way over there, because I would love to use that as my additional example. So with that, we tend to put them in their own place. And we begin to separate them. It's not just friends, it's family, loved ones. We begin to see when they act up, we want them to stand alone. But as they stand alone, our minds is trying to condition them to fit back into the pot and to bring them back into the place where they're supposed to be. But we're not gonna necessarily graft them in, perfect, but we're going to try to get them to see the need to change, to fit our play, okay? And oh my God, you know, I'm looking at this one. I don't pay attention to this one, so this one looks like it's doing a little bit better than this one, okay? So, wow, didn't realize that, okay? But anyway, as the Lord began to show me this, this is the family member that acts up. Never does what we tell them to do. Stints tend to struggle a little bit more. And the Lord says, this is the one that doesn't necessarily look like the rest of us. And not so pliable. But yet they could be family, they could be a friend. At one point in time, they was able to fit into that box. We would truly say, they outgrown us. Get it? And sometimes they outgrown us because they don't see things the way we see them. He said, nor do they look like you. He said, their ideas are skewed. And even to the point that the family has all come into the agreement that they're different. But then he says, but I want to say to you guys this. He said, the one that stands alone here doesn't pose a problem for me at all. He said, but the ones over here poses a problem for me. He said, because their expectations that I'm looking for someone to all be aligned and look identical to one another. He then goes on to say to me, I grafted each one of you in because you look different from one another. He said, not because you were the same, but you look different from one another. And in the place where you were, I found value in each of you. In the state and condition you were in. But even in the place where I found value in each one of you, he said, this one, also Paul balance and its state in its condition. And he said, I want to stop for a moment and have you guys to understand the state and condition of the other, the one that stands alone now. He says, struggles with their flesh, struggles with their identity. He said, although those that are in the pot together, they have the same identity issues, same struggles, but it's not readily seen. Because of the agreement that one another has with one another, they tend to be more patient because they're all fitting in the same box. And then he goes on to say to me something as simple as this. But if I was to pluck any of them out of this box, those that are left in the box would either consider themselves less or turn around and find fault in the one that's taken out of the box. Mm. Hopefully you guys got that. And he said, to that is something that I want to try to get you guys away from. He said, that place where you're examining one another. He said, say it like this. If I'm already struggling with me, and you being someone that's close to me, I'm gonna struggle with you too. And the reason why I'm going to struggle with you is because some of the things that's in you I desire to be. But what I'm seeing is what I haven't been able to accomplish within myself. And because I haven't accomplished it, you become a problem for me. And he says, and that's how you say, I don't know how to take you. I don't know how to deal with you. And Christ is literally saying, if we're all aligned together, whether we're in a separate pot or we're all in the same, we should be able to interact well with one another. The things that are standing out in us are the things that Christ desires to use or change. He said, say it like this. The things that are standing out in us, we're looking for a makeover. And Lord says, I am the makeover. Amen. The embrace of me causes these things to change in you. Yes. He says, it's not getting others to come to a place where they're able to walk with you. He said, it's getting others to understand that it's okay to be this in this place where you're in. I'm okay with me. And when you're okay with you, then others are okay with you as well. It's when you don't think others is okay with you and then you try to get them to be okay with you is the problem. He said, lots of work that's being done unnecessary. He said, when you love from his state, his point of view, you accept flaws. He said, you accept arrogance.
Yes.
You accept disappointment.
Yes.
He said you accept all behaviors. Amen. He said good and bad. Amen. He said because he said true love conquers all things. He said loving others from God's point of view. He said, not from the place that you expect others to walk.
Yes.
I don't know why he said this, but he popped in my head. He said, you know, it's like I expect Billy to be that voice that constantly corrects me in the nice and corrects and encourages me. And then the Lord just said, Billy will not always be in that place. He says, so therefore, when Billy doesn't do what you expect Billy to do, is Billy less of a friend to you or a confidant to you if he doesn't do it? I said, then I'm going to say, Lord, something wrong with Billy. He off. You know, something ain't right with Billy. Because Billy's not acting like what he's supposed to be. He said, get what I'm saying. No man is subject to stay the same. He said, you all have ups and downs. And he said, and it's allowed. He said, because it allows me an opportunity to interject in the places in which I'm desiring to strengthen and to grow you.
Amen.
He said, even when Billy's off, it allows me to change you. Did he get it? To meet Billy. Did you get that? So when Billy's off, God's going to cause me to see Billy the way he sees Billy, which will cause Billy to be whatever Billy's supposed to be in that place.
Yes.
But Billy can't be what he's supposed to be when I'm trying to pull Billy back down to what I need him to be for me. Hopefully you guys got that.
Yes.
I need you to be this. I need you to be this for me. I need you to be that for me. And God's saying, no, I need them to be them. And where you're lacking, you come to me. Get it? Where you're lacking, you're supposed to go to God. Well, this person's never, ever stood up in this place for me. Maybe they're not supposed to. Well, this person never, ever seemed to do what needs to be in this area. Maybe that's not their job. Maybe your expectations over that individual are off. We have false expectations with one another, especially family.
Ken.
Right on call. Speaking of
And in that place, we need to trust God. In that place, we need to believe for more. In that place, we need to stop putting our, how would I say it, Lord? Our expectations on others. Wow. You know, he reminds me of something else. So I'm downtown with the girls, I'll call it like that. And I see this outfit and I think it can go on Saida. And Saida turns around and says, oh my God, I'm offended, okay? I would never even consider something like that. And then in my mind, I'm like, Lord, how could she say she's offended? You know, I thought I dressed her pretty well. And then he said, but that's not her style. conversation with me. I said, she's got the legs, she can rock this, she's got the great hair, she can rock all of this. And then he said, but that's not her. And he said, accept her for who she is. He said, don't put your view or your stamp on her. Hopefully you guys got that. Because we always see people how we want them to be and not really seeing them that they're how they okay with. They're okay with themselves. And I know in my mind, I'm like, Lord, it was just a suggestion. And he said, but it was innocent. But if someone turns around and says, that's not me, don't take offense to it. Hopefully you guys got that too. Because we end up breaking relationship because of the fact that we say something and we have the expectation that that person's supposed to be in agreement. And then when they're not, you turn around and you say, well, shoot, she was in a bad mood that day. I only suggested this and that and that. And then the next time something else comes around that doesn't tend to stand up to what you want, then all of a sudden this person is in the pot by themselves and you're looking to sever the relationship. And it's over little things. Do you guys get it? Over little things. And let's go into scripture so that we can see this from the point. So, Charlie, help me to walk them through this one.
Luke chapter 22, verse 24. And there arose also a dispute among them as to which one of them was regarded to be greatest. And he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who have authority over them are called benefactors. I have to interject here the commentary on that verse. Benefactors, a title assumed by or voted for rulers in Egypt, Syria, and Rome as a display of honor, but frequently not representing actual service rendered. Verse 26. But it is not this way with you, but the one who is the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like the servant. For who is greater, the one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials. And just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I grant you, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
But I really want to focus. You have been with me through my trials. Did you guys get that point? Can you read that point again?
Verse 30.
Mm-hmm.
You may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones.
Not that part.
Verse 20.
Yes.
28.
You are those who have stood by me in my trials.
Did you guys get that? That's what. We're supposed to stand by one another as we go through trials and tribulation. We're supposed to be that support to one another. And when one person tend to step out and they no longer look like the rest of the flock, we're still supposed to be in that position to stand by them, to begin to help to support them. And so when they come back, and the next one leads out, then we're supposed to stand and by that individual. To we're standing by every single one of them as God elevates us in Him, and we truly become that support to one another. We're never gonna always look alike. We're never gonna always be the same as we met each other. We're growing, we're changing. God is enhancing us every single day, and as He continues to move, we're there to support one another. Amen. We can't push somebody off because they don't look like us anymore, or they have grown and to where they're much larger than us, and then we don't know how to handle them. We're still supposed to be interacting and loving each other as we continue to mature. We never want everybody to fit into the same pot, because then we're all looking the same, and that's not how God grafted us in. He grafted each one of us in because we were different from one another. And each one of us had something that was different, but we all had something that was alike. And that likeness will always remain. But it's going to look a little different as we mature, but it's still there. And so we're still supposed to interact, and we can't be in that position that we push one of them off. How do I say this, Lord? He said, will you stand with the individual, meaning your family, your loved ones, as they walk through? Will you be that support to the other person? He said, if you're saying yes, would you lay aside what type of support you expect them to be for you? And just love them where they're at. Yeah. And let them be them. I have four sisters. And my four sisters are completely different. My youngest sister constantly remind me of love. Constantly remind me of love. My oldest sister is my ride or die. And what I mean by that is we grew up together. We were thick and thin. My two middle sisters, I can truly say, you know, I don't have a strong relationship with them, but they're my sisters. And my expectation, wow, I just looked at what the Lord, they've always been the same. I can't necessarily say that our relationship has blossomed and grown to another level. And the main reason why it hasn't blossomed or grown to another level is that how would I say it, Lord? He said, there are relationships that I don't invest in. Because they don't fit all the way into my pot. They are different. And sometimes I find myself pushing them off to the side. And the Holy Spirit is literally saying that they need me. As a big sister, to be there to provide that guidance and support. He even says to me that they've always have looked up to me. But I've never given them an opportunity to grow in relationship with me because of the fact that they were different. People who are different, we normally toss them to the side. Or they stay or remain stagnant in our relationship. He said, what I'm asking you is to take the opportunity and look at the relationships you do have and begin to give it value. And that is to love them and to surrender your expectations of what they're supposed to look like. And he said, Be a voice for me. By being in that place and accepting who they are. He said, but most of all, help them to grow by relinquishing how you see them. Let's go through a little bit more of the scripture because I want to drive this home a little bit more. I just got a little bit more to share, but I think it'll help to edify you as well.
Daniel chapter 4, just real quickly here, so you can read the full context, but basically at the beginning of Daniel chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar has now acknowledged Yahweh, the Most High God, as being real. A little bit before that, Daniel 2, he gets the vision of the statue. Daniel says there's a God in heaven who interprets dreams. He's the Most High. Skip ahead. When Nebuchadnezzar wants all of Israel to worship him and the statue, and he throws Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fire, he sees the angel of the Lord in the fire. And so now, chapter 4, he's acknowledged that God is real, like God. And then he gets a vision of a tree. He sees a mighty tree that gets cut down. He goes to Daniel, and he gets the interpretation of the dream, and Daniel basically says, the tree is you, and you're going to be cut down. Now, starting in Daniel chapter 4, verse 28, all this happened to Nebuchadnezzar the king. 12 months later, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. The king reflected and said, is this not Babylon the Great, which I myself built as a royal residence by the might of my power and for the glory of my majesty? While the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice came from heaven saying, King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is declared, sovereignty has been removed from you, and you will be driven away from mankind, and your dwelling place will be with the beasts of the field. You will be given grass to eat like cattle, and 7 periods of time will pass over you until you recognize the Most High is ruler over the realm of mankind and bestows it on whomever he wishes. Immediately the word concerning Nebuchadnezzar was fulfilled, and he was driven away from mankind and began eating grass like cattle, and his body was drenched in the dew of heaven until his hair had grown like eagle's feathers and his nails like bird's claws. Verse 34, but at the end of that period, I, Nebuchadnezzar, raised my eyes toward heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, but he does according to his will in the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And no one can ward off his hand or say to him, what have you done?
Wow. As I began to look at that, the Holy Spirit was literally saying, because you sit back and you look at what Nebuchadnezzar been through, and you say, Lord, in this particular lifetime, this doesn't happen to us anymore. And he says, how many times have you walked through a place to whereby you esteemed and exalted something and I had to remove it?
Psalm 52, it's around there. Wow. God does not change.
Yes. And he literally shows me at a point in time to whereby you probably idolized or worship a car, a vehicle, or a person, and God removed that little thing that you were basically exalting away from you. And it caused you to look just like everybody else. And you came running back to the group, and what happened? They accepted you back in. And so what God is basically trying to get us to understand that when we outside of ourselves, he has a way of humbling us and calling us to be grafted back into the place that we were supposed to be in all the time.
Yes.
He goes on to say, I never look for my body to be separated from me, but there's times where I have to cause you to see the need to humble yourself and to really align with me.
Amen.
And so as I begin to look at this, I may have used material ways to look at it, but there's times where you'll be in the midst of a conversation and everybody will be in disagreement and you think what you have to say is something great and nobody agrees, and then you got to come to that place where you have to humble yourself because you're overstated. And you even will get mad to the point to whereby, you know, how could they not agree with me? And then you try to get some allies in your place, and everybody in that place says, well, I agree and side with them. And in that place you move, but then you find yourself standing on the other side, I'll say in this plant by yourself, but then you know that nobody's there with you, and then you go back and you try to get back in the group. And so it's so important to understand that we should not be pushing people out, but we should always be understanding to one another and not forcing our views and our ways upon. You know, if I was to go to my two younger middle sisters and say, I expect you to be like this to me, then I'm off. And for the two that I said that I see them, if I was to go and try to change them, I would be off. They're my sisters. I can't change that. But I can strengthen the relationship I have with them by really accepting them for who they are. And not trying to get them to fit into what I think they should be. You should be over here and supporting me, or you should do this and you should do that. No. It's not about that. It's about you being in that place of understanding of one another. I'm asking God, do you want me to go there? Oh my God, you want me to go there, Lord? I'll give another example. You know, recently I was talking about weddings, and it's been so many weddings going forward in top quality faith ministries. Wow, I just see people just having weddings. And with that, you know, I remember when I was going and I was preparing for a wedding. I remember my oldest sister was the first to get married. And I was very upset at her because she picked my cousin. Do you hear what I'm saying? She picked my cousin to be the matron of honor. But I was her ride and die. Do you get it? I was her ride and die. I paid all her bills when she fell short. I did all of these things that was I was supposed to do in my mind as a sister to help you. And so when it came to the announcement, she told me I was going to be in her wedding party. Wait a minute. I'm going to be in her wedding party? And I was pissed off, okay? And I remember coming to the place to where I was so mad that she had to have two of them, okay? She had to have two matrons of honor because I wasn't going to go down quietly, okay? And I'm serious, refused to go down quietly. And she just said, okay, you're going to be it, okay? And I was thrilled to be it. I didn't even know how to walk down the aisle, okay? And I think about, she kept saying, I need you to just walk in, just be yourself. I was so caught up in myself that the day of the wedding, I don't even know how I was walking, okay? But it was not something that was real, and it took me a long time to get down there because I just had my ideas how a person's supposed to walk down the aisle. That's a matron of honor. Everybody's supposed to stop and look at her. Forget about the bride. Look at me. And I remember my sister later on saying, you know, I love you, but did you have to send me through all of that? Because I thought in my relationship with her, hopefully you get it, that I was her all in all, because she was my all in all. And I was mad because she didn't see me as her all in all. And I was very offended. Because I'm like, I take care of you, I do this, I do that. And then I had to stop. She said, I never asked you to do these things for me. You just did them. And so my expectations of my sister was totally off. And sometimes our expectations of others and how others are supposed to operate in our lives is totally off. We need to begin to really understand the relationship we have with Christ to understand the relationship we have with others.
Amen.
And we can't get offended if somebody is not your ride and die, or if somebody doesn't apply themselves the way we want. You're supposed to be my sister, and you're supposed to operate that way. That's why my two middle sisters are stuck in the place I got them, because I have an expectation that they operate a certain way for me, and because they're not operating the way I want, I haven't advanced the relationship.
Yes.
I haven't invested in the relationship because, guess what? You're not doing what I need you to do, okay? I don't see God showing that you're Holy Ghost filled right now. I know you go to church, but you're not going to church enough where I can see fruit. So therefore, I'm going to keep you on the side. I'm just being real. I heard somebody in the background say, dang, but I'm being real. You don't have enough Jesus for me. And so I'm not going to invest in you because you don't have enough Christ for me. And so therefore, your Christ doesn't look like what? The box that I put everybody in. So therefore, I'm going to leave you out on the outside. But the other one, because she's loving, she's been through a lot of challenges in life, and God brought her up and out of this stuff, she qualifies. But the other two, But that's me. Imagine how you see the things that's going on the inside of you. And God is literally saying to lay down that junk. Leave that junk at the altar.
Amen.
Because we're operating just like Nebuchadnezzar. It's about us. When it's supposed to be about Christ.
Amen.
Get it? It's about us. And then we're wondering why we're having problems with people. We have problems because it's a problem in us. It's how we see one another, and we don't see them through the eyes of Christ. I'm mad at you, sister. I'm mad at you, brother, because you don't fit into here.
Yeah.
And I think last week when I was sharing out the message that I was mad at my brother because he didn't do this and he didn't fit in. But he is who he is, and I cannot make him be what I need him to be.
Yeah.
And that's a problem, because I'm trying to make him into something that he will never be. He's him. And shame on me to try to force him to be what I need him to be. And I'm telling him constantly, if you were sober, then guess what? We will have a better relationship. And he's saying, sister, I am what I am. I've been dealing with this all my life, but it's not good enough for me. So in return, I'm saying, fix it, fix it, fix it, because you can't be in my space if you don't fix it. And God is saying, allow him in, love him. Love him where he's at so he can change. Accept him for who he is. And stop trying to make him fit into your world.
Yes.
Because your world doesn't allow me to roam freely. Get that? Your world doesn't allow Christ to roam freely. Because in your world, you got certain expectations that God should do for you as well. And when God doesn't line up, you treat him just like you treat your family.
Yes.
Oh,
God. Hopefully you get this.
Lord have mercy.
So it's okay for others to be who they are. And we fail to understand this is a fallen earth. We have expectations that people are supposed to look perfect. And we ain't even operating in a perfect setting. He said, none of you have arrived.
Wow, Lord.
None of you are there. And then I said, Lord, am I a little bit close? He said, for you even thinking that you close, you way off. Am I a little bit there, Lord? Am I a little bit there? No!
Your hand must be limp for him to pat your back.
Exactly. Say that louder.
Your hands must be limp for him to pat your back. You never pat your own back, not even a tap.
Praise be to God. Praise be to God. So let's go ahead and wrap this up and come into the other.
Yeah, Romans 11:18a in principle. Do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. He gave me extra. Romans 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will.
And we would know what the will of God for our families. We would know what the will of God, why they're there, why they're struggling, why they're going through. All this stuff we would know because we would be in a position to hear. And the reason why we're not in a position to hear because we're always trying to be the fixer. Let me fix you so that I can deal with you. And we shouldn't be trying to fix one another. You want to know why family has battles? Because everybody's trying to make them fit into whatever. And somebody in the family has had a conversation with somebody else. And that conversation was, this one doesn't do this and the other one agreed. And not realizing that the two that agreed was off. Hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us today, you guys. Accept one another as they are. And welcome them into the place and begin to work on the relationships that you have with one another. If you see something that's faulty, don't be there to pick it out all the time. You know, help them. Or better yet, if you see something, be willing to pick it, okay? That you may help them become the best of themselves.
Praise God.
Hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Any other scriptures that we have before we wrap up?
One did just come to mind. One second, please.
Wow. I thank God for the word today. And I am highly blessed by the words in which he's basically saying. I would sit back, because I do that with new believers too, because sometimes I kind of expect that they've been under top quality or they've been in the church for a while, that they should be speaking somewhat the same language, and that's off. I can't force you to rise because God is the one that elevates each and every one of us.
Amen.
And I can never have the expectancy that you are the same because God is constantly changing us.
Yeah, that was 1 Peter 5, but this is Isaiah 52:7. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace or shalom, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who says, Zion, your God reigns.
Praise God.
Amen.
And so with that, I thank you, Lord, for the message today. I close not because I'm going to have Takiya close us in prayer.
Lord, we thank you for this message. Father, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for the revelation that came forward, the truth that was spoken to each and every one of our hearts. We love you, Lord, for you are pruning us, you're strengthening us, you're renewing our mind with your word today. And I pray that this word has blessed each and every listener, Lord. And we honor you and glorify you in your mighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
And so, Charlie, what would you say to that new believer that's listening to this message?
Read John 14.
And how would you pray them into the kingdom?
That you don't have to do the work. Christ has done the work for you. Just trust and surrender him, and then he'll do the work he wants to do through you.
And so with that, I invite and I welcome you, if you're willing to surrender it even now, And in Christ Jesus' name, I welcome you to the body of Christ by simply saying, or are you repeating after me, Lord, come into my life, be my Lord, be my Savior. Lift this off of me as I completely surrender all men unto you. And let my expectation of all those who are in my life today be your expectation, that I just love them as they are in Christ Jesus' name. And help me where I have found fault in them, as I see it in my eyes, to see them as you see them. In Christ Jesus' name, this is my prayer. In your agreement, we both say amen. For those of you who are in need of prayer, Top Quality Faith Ministries line is always open for anyone that needs prayer. So I'll see you guys on our next one. Be blessed and a blessing to all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Bye.